And you have vitamin water.
It's good enough for Phineas.
Good enough. Things. Hello. Oh, they're on.
Hello, hello. No!
Oh, fail. Try yours.
Good.
Oh, wait, hello. Now it's on.
Yep, that's on.
Okay, it's on. That is on. Should we start? Is it time to start?
Yeah! What time is it, guys?
Time to start.
Let's
just sit here and stare at you for a minute.
Look at all the lovely people.
And judge them. Oh my god, good morning, everyone!
Good morning!
Oh, that was lame. You can so do better than that.
Good morning, everyone!
Good morning!
I think one more.
One more.
Why don't you ask them this time?
Good morning, everyone.
Fair to Midland. Oh my god.
So
we might have a couple more voice actors joining us. We don't know. They're probably.
Maybe.
So in the meantime, while we wait for some other people that may be asleep somewhere under a table in one of the upper floors of the hotel.
Hey, no shame.
No shame in that. You sleep,
you can. We will just start. I guess,
should we introduce ourselves and just kind of go down the line? Ladies first.
All right. I actually had to text myself.
I'm going to call you again.
Are you really? Okay, sweet.
Existential crisis.
By the way, for anybody that was at opening ceremonies,
that was
totally called
her.
Me.
I was hoping there'd be like a really freaky ringtone. Like, why is that my ringtone? Why is the psycho shower scene music my ringtone?
I thought it was giving you the. Just let it ring, don't answer.
Okay, so. Hi, everybody. I'm Lauren Landa, a voice actress from LA. And let's see, some of my roles include Blaze Blue, Lai Chi Fei Ling, Blazing Souls Exhalate, Lisa, Boy Boy in Redline, Little Queen in Tales of Graces. I'll save that till the end. Let's see, Arf and Chrono in Magical Girl Lyrical Nanoha, Kierke von Zerbst in Familiar of Zero, Rena in Luminous Arc 2, Leisha in Soul Calibur 5, and Kyoko Sakura in Madoka Magica. Who are you, lovely sir?
I don't know anymore.
Well, I heard somebody say Tatum, so somebody knows who you are.
Thank God these people follow me around because I remember who I am. I'm like, oh yeah! That's my name.
That's why they give me a sign. Really.
I know.
Is there one on this side? Oh, there is. But there's one here.
It's mostly
so famous. I remember.
Oh, I am J. Michael Tatum. Weird last name.
So it's J. Michael Tatum, everyone. I'm a voice actor and writer and sometime ADR director, and I've been in tons of stuff. Oh my god, I really need to start like looking at my Wikipedia page. Like,
oh, I know, that's why I texted
you. Oh, that. But yeah, I was in, I think probably the more notable ones would be
Italia as France. Kyoya Otari in Orano's Bacano.
God, tons of other stuff. Oh, there's a little show. What is it called? It's like really obscure. No one has seen it. Black Butler.
Yeah! You just had to do that, didn't you?
All the time. Like, some people actually get offended by that. Like, what do you mean it's about? I'm kidding. I'm fully aware of like that everyone and their grandmother has seen it twice.
Yes. Grammy loves Black Butler.
Grammy loves Black Butler. I'm sure someone's
grandmother
does.
Yeah.
It's like,
The taste of empire.
It's the taste of empire. Yeah, and I
don't get these two in a room together.
I know, until like no one else exists.
Come on, we just have a nerf fest.
Yeah, don't get
we're in the same. We're in the same.
You should have really talked to the programming people.
I know.
Like months ago. So that's me in a nutshell, and I don't know of any. I'm a rambler, so I'm just gonna turn it on to the lovely lady to my.
Sexy lady.
What? Whoa. Unexpected morning. I'm Patrick Seitz. There's like a bunch of excited little owls. thank you for that. I just got done watching Twin Peaks and now I'm really freaked out by it. I was Germany in Italia. And I was Agni in Black Butler. I was Simon in Durarara selling the sushis. And Fenric and Disgaea 4 and a bunch of other stuff.
other stuff too. It's on the interwebs. Stuff.
See, this one comes prepared. She's making us look bad. She's like, I have a list.
He's supposed to have a list.
Well, I have a list. I just assume that nobody cares.
Okay. Oh, they care.
I get three titles in. They're like, oh, I got up early for this. Oh, one more. Senji in Dead Man Wonderland.
Woo!
Oh, yeah.
It's a moonlight.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Welcome to the first.
Oh, God. Patrick, stop touching me. Oh, that was you.
Okay. I felt like a basketball team was
I'm
running.
Sorry, Tatum. I couldn't help you.
I'm going to switch tables. And
no, I'm not.
That was
the little
weird.
Intro.
I was like, when the lights come up and there's a dead body on the floor with a mask.
We're going to need here until we get to the bottom.
I'm on a mystery party.
Yeah.
That would be awesome. Yeah.
Awesome. So I guess, do you want to just open it up to
Q-A.
Questions? So.
Yeah.
Okay, so Q&A, the you provide Q, we provide A. I will warn you.
When we can.
Yeah, I will warn you, the A that comes out of my mouth often is, check your facts, I'm so full of it. I'm really getting to the point where I'm just like, oh, I'm just going to make stuff up now so people think all sorts of things about me. I'm really going to start writing a bio that the ones you have to publish in the little the programming books, it's going to be wildly different every time.
He was born in a prison, the worst place ever.
I was born in a
fictional
Latin American
freedom.
Country, and I didn't even see the light of day until I was a grown man, but whatever. And
I could buy you as Bane.
I would love to be Bane, oh my god. Except the mask, that would suck.
Yeah.
That would suck. That would impede my voice.
I'm off my ADR session. Grow Michael Taylor.
So we like random questions. If you have questions like for specific people like us, that's really cool too. But we also like it like questions we can all answer so that none of us like feel like
left out.
And all the CL hands go down. No,
and we'll take turns. Right?
Yeah. Why don't we start with
Patrick? So Patrick, why don't you pick the first questioner? Oh, who's got? Let's see a show of hands. Who's got a question?
Yes, the banana.
Oh my Patrick,
you're a banana. Awesome.
Do you like sandwiches?
Ask any show receive.
I said, like, do you like sandwiches?
I love sandwiches.
Does anyone ever say no to that question? Like, oh, no, sandwiches. I hate sandwiches.
The devil.
Do you like
sandwiches? I love the idea of the sandwich.
The sandwich is an idea, right?
Sometimes it takes physical form. It's like the platonic sandwich on the wall.
This is what happens when the two of them are in a room together. They analyze everything.
Sandwiches are good. I mean, there are some sandwiches I don't like, not to sound intolerant. But I like the idea of, like, I can just put these ingredients between two pieces of bread and be on the go, so if I want to stay up all night playing poker, like the Earl of Sandwich did.
The Earl of Sandwich. Yeah. It's named after a guy.
Because he was playing his cards, and they were like, so I'm going to eat some food. I decided his manservant sounds like Bane. He's like, no, just slap it between pieces of bread and bring it to me, so I may eat it.
Because the meat was very greasy, and it got all over the cards. You know?
And such
so Bane was like, well, then let's put bread. And then he was like, oh, brilliant. And then the sandwich was like, how many people get a food named after them? Right?
Earl of Sandwich. Not Earl Sandwich. Earl of Sandwich. Like, his real name was probably like Robert or something.
He's like, I have to eat a sandwich three times a day now just to keep up.
Yeah, like, what a pain, right?
Someday I would be the Duke of Sandwich.
And you don't want to be friends with like Earl Oyster on the Half Shell.
I wouldn't like an oyster sandwich.
Cool.
Yeah,
No. I like sandwiches. They're very simple. I like sandwiches, I guess. I like sandwiches generally. I mean, there are certain kinds of sandwiches I don't like. Yeah. As an idea, as like a genre of foodstuffs, I think the sandwich is a brilliant idea. I'm not very successful in the kitchen. So anything that I can just put together, I'm like, I have two pieces of bread and I put stuff on it and I close it.
With anything between it.
I love it. It's very liberating for
it
because you could really do anything you want with it. It doesn't even have to be edible. If you don't want your sandwich to be edible, like, I'm making a cardboard sandwich. It's still technically a sandwich.
There you go. Sandwiches are yummy. Okay, it's your turn.
Oh, my turn? Okay, he's got another question. You in the front row.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
So, huge fan of Patrick Stites. I saw him here 2 years ago. I asked
Me too.
About chairs. It was wonderful. It was very... Woo!
Oh, people!
Join us!
Sorry we're late. We got caught under a bus.
And they brought you yogurt.
They brought you yogurt for everybody.
Ooh. Do you want to feed it to your hands?
Actually, I'm good.
Introduce yourselves.
Hi, I'm
We'll get back to your questions.
Hi, my
Did you switch it on?
Those who are late do not get working microphones.
This is too confusing already.
I cannot work in these conditions.
My name's Chuck Huber. More? I do the voice of Hiei in Yu Yu Hakusho. Android 17, Garlic Jr., Hero in Shin Chan, Austria in Hetalia, Dr. Stein in Soul Eater, Hululu in Sergeant Frog, random people in lots of.
Damn! That's my favorite.
Go, Leah!
Hi, I'm Leah Clark. Woo! A lot of random people and a lot of things. That's great. Now, I do Blair and Soul Eater. Thanks. I could never remember these. Notica in Enigma. Fuki in Sergeant Frog. Oh, Saki in Eden of the East. And what's that girl? This is, like, crazy girl that I'm playing. What is her name?
Deadly Leah
Wonderland.
Clark.
Yes. Deadly Wonderland and Minatsuki. And other fun things.
Do you guys like sandwiches?
That was our first question. We only got our second question. Do you like sandwiches? It's not a lot of questions. We don't have sandwiches like stuff.
Sounds like a euphemism for something. I'm going to say yes, and everyone's going to laugh. Oh, do you like pickles on your sandwich?
No.
All this before we came in?
No, we really meant sandwiches.
What is wrong with you?
I have no idea, Michael Tatum. No idea.
It was just, do you like sandwiches?
I like
sandwiches. Never mind, I don't want you to answer anymore.
Sandwiches are awesome, especially with bread.
Oh, no, you didn't.
I did.
Genius.
I went there.
Okay, so you had a question there, and you were talking about how you loved... Oh,
yeah, I love Pat. All right. And so I was at the panel last night, and she was talking a bit about how sometimes you just have a voice, and you're kind of born with it. And, like, there's not a lot of cheating. You're just kind of born with it. But then I saw him, like, do the old trick where it's, like, going into deeper tones where he leaned back. So I'm wondering if that was something he just learned by himself doing this a lot, or how much is trained. Like you go, you practice a lot, and like someone's like, oh, if you lean back, you can go into the deeper tones. Or
I mean, from doing theater and from doing, I took voice lessons for a long time. Not so much like voice acting, but actual singing. Classical. I was 18 and goofy and weighed like 150 pounds, and my voice was just like, here, sing the magic flute, pretend you're like a 40-year-old badass. I'm like, what? No! Okay.
You had a really cool biker teacher.
He was.
Sing like a badass.
Get in this sidecar, boy! I'm taking this baby to Mexico! You're going to sing that Saba Flota in Mexico! I mean, just things you learn. I mean, if you're all scrunched up, you're not going to be as resonant as if you are open, little tricks like having one foot slightly in front of the other for support, if you're really belting it out. Just stuff you pick up on. I mean, most of the low was already there. Just an accident of birth.
He drinks brandy every night.
Don't I wish. Mostly just things you pick up during the course of it. There's not like a hidden like tome that they like take out of a safe and they like blow the dust off of it and then they hand it to you and you feed it after midnight and it becomes a griffin.
Old Chinese man gives you to you. You are not ready for this responsibility.
General question. I mean,
that was
talent.
Oh, that's for all of us. Oh,
damn it.
I don't know. I mean, the body is a big part of how your voice sounds. So even if it's not necessarily changing your tone, but what Patrick said last night, which is very important for anyone who likes to fool around with their voice to try to, you know, go higher or lower, just to do trick voices or whatever, things that are not in their comfortable range, you have to manage that very, very carefully, because if you don't, you will destroy the range you have. And I mean, there's certain, I used to be able to go very, very high, and I simply can't anymore, because as you age and you use more of your lower tone, the high stuff's not there anymore. That's fine. I mean, there's no shortage of smarmy sounding guys in anime, so I'm like, I'm fine.
I mean, the way I look at it, I'm just gonna get older and lower and gravelier, and eventually no one's gonna be able to hear me but like dogs and humpback whales.
By the time you're in your 80s, every time you open your mouth, it will screw with the foundation of an entire city block.
Plate tectonics! I'll be like the village elder that no one can hear, but suddenly all of your fillings like pop. That's gonna be awesome.
Like the mystics in Dark Crystal. But it's interesting how, and some of this you just learn by doing it. It's interesting, like, the relationship you have to your body, like the way you're standing or the way you will move, or even just where your hands are, or how you're, whether you're like standing straight, backed, or with your shoulders slashed, has a great deal of effect on your voice, more so than you would know. Like, it's very subtle, but you hear it. I learned from, you know, the first director I worked with in the industry was Bevins, Chris Bevins. And he was a big, big fan of like telling you to stand a certain way or to do certain movements. And it's surprising how it changes your voice.
So he just wanted to see you dance.
Dance. He's a bit of a bastard like that. But I love him. But yeah, it's interesting. And I think, like for me, it's... my voice used to be really, really, when I was very young, when I was in my like early teens, I had such a high, kind of girly voice. I mean, I don't know what happened.
I'm intrigued.
tell me more. I had a high, very girly voice, and so much so that, you know, if I called somebody on the phone, like a business or something, or went through a drive-thru, they'd be like, "Yes, ma'am," pull around, and be like, "I'm not a ma'am, I am a guy." Whatever. And it deepened over time when I started getting when on stage, because I did a lot of stage work from like 9 years old on. And once I got to that age where I kind of filled out sooner than a lot of people, so I was much bigger. So I started getting roles that were older than me, and so I had to push my voice down. And over time, within a very actually not such a long period of time, within a few years, my voice got significantly deeper. And suddenly, it's, you know, not a big deal for me to sound like that. I could never get as low as you.
I'd like to think this happened in the drive-thru. God, like the Whopper's a fries. Just get to the window, though. Just take it. It's free. It's on me. Just go.
Hurry before I change again.
Crazy bunch of people. Crazy. Oh, about me. Well, I mean, I think it's a little different for women than it is for men. Sometimes women, their voices tend to drop. Mine, I am not sure if it's gone anywhere, really. The higher pitch characters that I usually play are a little out of my comfort zone. Kyoko especially, because she's very high pitched. Very high pitched.
Sorry, getting
really. Did I get a squeak? Oh, no, squeak. Simple, you know, it's just very out of my comfort zone. Usually my comfort zone is very low. Very
her comfort zone sensitive. Is your comfort zone.
That's my comfort zone. But, Chuck, do you have anything to add?
I think the way you use your face really affects your voice. Like, when I'm starting to figure out a character, I usually find it like making the face of the character. And that helps you sort of get your body into it. And especially when doing, like, the physical stuff, I have to actually do it, and I usually hurt myself or other people in the room.
I'm sitting over here.
I mean, right here. I've already punched Leah three times. Why are you sad? I punched her. My hand hurt. Leah?
I don't really do anything physical to change my voice. I do something that's really odd, I think, in that I imagine the sound in my head. Like, I'll see the face of the character, and I'll hear it in my head, and then I just go ahead and mimic what I'm hearing. So... Wow. And I noticed that I stand really ugly when I record, and it doesn't matter which character it is, it's always ugly, but it's like something like this. But it was just funny because I was doing this and recording, and I think it was Joel, and I looked out and he was laughing, and I was like, what? And he's like, what are you doing? I don't know.
You should have said, helps. You don't see him?
I think we're ready for another question. And it's my turn.
Your turn.
I'm gonna do the pink ears, you.
Ears aren't pink.
Oh, well, they're
there's
inside. They're pink.
There's pink inside of them.
Yes, thank you.
They're partly pink. Okay.
The pink hair. How about that? Is that better?
Actually, I was wondering specifically for someone who's currently pursuing voice acting. I'm an audiobook reader. Is there an easy, well, or really direct route to get into specifically voice acting as opposed to, I'm an actress and I can act things or, you know, plays and productions, what would be the correct route to go to say, hi, I want to be in cartoons?
Well, we were just talking about this, actually. Most people don't, I mean, some people say, I want to do cartoons, I want to do voices for cartoons, but they don't always usually say, I only want to do voice acting.
Yeah.
Most of the time it is usually, no, I want to be an actor, I want to be an actress, and that's...
I like being behind a microphone.
Oh, we all do. That's why we're here.
That's my comfort zone. I'm like, yes, you cannot see me.
And that is wonderful, and there's something very liberating about being behind a microphone. But the thing about, here's the trick, there is doing what you love, and there's being able to make a living at it, and there are two very different things. And in the acting world, any creative job of whatever caliber, you have to cast your net extraordinarily wide to be able to just get your foot in the door, let alone make a living once you do. So it's kind of, and I don't mean to crush your dreams. I mean, it's a great idea that you want to be a voice actor.
No, crush them, Tatum, crush them. But
the reality is, make people cry.
It's going to be good cop, bad cop.
The reality of it is to those of us kind of in the industry, like, all, first of all, there is no tried and true path. Like, all of us kind of found our way into it. In like
absolutely.
Our own unique way, and so there is no qualification for like, well, if you do exactly like my story is like, well, you wait around and just kind of not do anything for 20 years and then wait for somebody you know to ask you to come and audition. I wouldn't advise following. you know, but and other people get into theater and they make contacts and they meet other actors who happen to work at a studio and then they hear about an audition or something. I mean, everyone has their own way, but the thing about especially like dub acting or you know video game or any kind of voice acting for cartoons, things like that is extraordinarily niche. And it's very rare, the people you find in it, it's not often that they set out to do this. It's part of just a larger bag of tricks that they're able to do, and they found it through other things they're already doing professionally. So you may not be very comfortable with, say, doing stage work or things like that, but I would recommend you at least try it, because you need to have as big a net as possible. Because wanting to just get into, you have to kind of be, it's such a competitive field, really, that the more you narrow down what you want, what your end game is, the less likely you are to get in. It's kind of like saying, I want to be an architect who specializes in doorknobs.
Actually a very good example.
I mean, it's kind of, so you really have to, you know, just kind of go out there and do all sorts of acting. So do stage. But I mean, the thing is, there's all kinds of acting you can do behind a mic, not just for cartoons. You can get into radio, you can do, you know, audiobooks, things like that, all kinds of things like that, but you have to be willing to do all kinds. So don't like get tunnel vision with one specific thing, because it's very, very difficult.
And to add to that, something I always tell people is you guys live in a time where you don't have to wait for anybody to give you permission to do something. Mm. You could take your iPhone in this yogurt tin and give it a voice and make a story like Marcel the Shell, and suddenly it's about a yogurt thing and you did the voice to it. You could have that done tonight. Put it up on YouTube, and then you're voice acting. I mean, you're doing what you want to do. And if you get good enough at it, people notice, and then you take it to the next level. As far as having a way to eat and make money, you got to do everything. I mean, and it does include, it's good experience to do stage acting, but, you know, if you're willing to do whatever you need to do to make food happen on the table, you could start voice acting right now. Get the hell out of here. Go, voice act.
Well, theater definitely helps train you for everything.
That's true.
And so it's highly recommended to take theater classes, and you said you're comfortable behind a mic, so I understand how it's very nerve-wracking to get on stage in front of people, trust me.
I actually don't know if it is. I haven't done it since... Cool.
Try it.
You should totally try it. You
try
may,
it.
May
do
learn
it right
that
now.
You...
Ready? Come on.
Yeah.
I'll come up there and dance for you if you like.
maybe not. But I'm kidding. I'm kidding. But
Have a tail.
That would, I guess.
Does
that I like how that was going to change your answer. Oh, well, hang on. She has a tail. Hold on.
That would seem perhaps to be. Does that give you an advantage when you're dancing, having a tail? That would seem to get in the way. That's like one more thing to trip over. Yeah, but this is me. I don't dance. I'm like, I trip over myself. But I guess the bottom line is, you know, don't be so, like, just don't be so, you know, focused on one particular thing that you lose sight of other things you don't even have a concept of as something you would like to do, let alone be good at. Because all of us kind of found what we do and what we love now by just, it just happened to us because we followed a much broader path.
You never get everything you want.
An end game in mind.
Yeah, exactly. So far, I've done, like, commercial voiceovers and narration and audiobooks, and that's all I've done.
Awesome.
That's
awesome.
A lot.
Well, you know, take some theater workshops, as Lauren suggests.
It
I mean, because
really
acting in particular is not, it's a communal art. You cannot really hone your skills in isolation, even if you may have a great voice, but you need to be around other people and feed off of them, play off of them, get feedback from them in real time, especially other actors will tell you exactly how badly you suck. And you need that kind of feedback. Actors are brutally honest with each other.
Pick a question. A question. Let's go far in the back at the blue camera. It looks blue.
It is.
Good.
Yes.
This is a question for J. Michael. So, I always tend to think that, like, the characters you do end up sounding kind of like really smart and proper, like Kyoya and Sebastian. When you did Isaac and Meccano, he's all happy-go-lucky and ditzy and just all over the place. Was that, like, really, like, different for you?
No, actually, Isaac came very easily because you may have noticed I'm a very goofy person. The whole, like, I tend to get typecasted playing suave, like, intelligent-sounding characters, I don't really understand how that happened.
He's lying.
I don't.
Really, Tim?
We want
really?
You to act.
Well, yeah, no, we're acting, but that is, believe me, that is acting when I do those characters, when I'm very calm and centered and I use big words, you know, like, that
it's
very
so
rarely happens.
Right?
No,
it's totally a lie.
That takes a lot of tranquilizer darts to get you.
No. Turn him again. With Isaac? No. Like, oh my God, Lauren, let's go rob a liquor store. Like, that's me on a Saturday. It was interesting. I was talking about this the other day. It's really, I think, I've done my share of kind of the crazy, big over the top characters. Isaac is just kind of the best known of them, but you know, they're rare for me. Most people remember the glasses wearing characters, the people that go, yes, big word. Intimidate. I find personally that the characters that are really crazy and over the top are not so much easier to do physically. Physically, they can be very demanding on your voice because it's, you know, you're screaming all the time or whatever. But in terms of, like, your choice as an actor, like the choice of read, like how do I deliver this line, it's so suggested by the animation and just by their level of energy that you have fewer choices available. Like, you know, if the character's doing this, they're not going to sound like this. Generally, their tone's going to have to match their energy. But with the crazy characters that aren't terribly emotive, that play it very close to the chest, they're not emotive, so you have this huge array of choices in like how you could read this line. Like you could emphasize this word, you could soften it up here a little bit, you can maybe put a double entendre in there. And so you have there's a minefield of choices, and you can make mistakes that way. And so I find the crazy characters are challenging physically, but I think the more the suave,
the clear
characters are more mysterious and more difficult. And I find that to be challenging. It's very easy on the vocal cords, but it's very difficult in terms of like, well, how do I read this line without making him sound dry? You know, so. I like it. Thank you for telling me many of my characters sound intelligent. Now I will be insufferable.
Thanks.
Who wants to pick another question? Leah,
it's
your turn. Pick a question.
Right there.
Me?
You, yes.
Okay. My young master has a question.
I like where this is going.
So if each and every one of you could pick a certain character out of any anime and say one line in that voice, could you do that?
Let's start with Leah. Let's start with Leah.
You did it! You did this!
I didn't. Yeah, I just like the cosplay.
Oh my God, you and me are going to talk about picking people in Black Butler cosplay for quick. You got to be prepared for anything.
Who wants to go first?
You go first. We all want, we vote you.
I choose you.
requests for certain characters. Yes, with the hand. The only one in the room with the hand, right there.
No.
Blair, yes. I'm trying to think of the line. It's one of my favorite ones that she has. I never said I was a witch, did I? I'm just a cat with a ridiculous amount of magical power. Yeah! Thanks.
I don't know what to do.
Wait, I got one. You have to guess.
Fetch, Nina. Fetch. Oh,
that's cold. Bring it. Kuwabara, you're such an idiot.
Simon? You want to say?
Germany!
Germany! Football!
Germany!
42!
Is Simon doing Germany?
No! It's like no. We can talk about Russia sushi, huh? You like, you buy?
Because if you asked the question, I'll just do Sebastian. Let me do it.
They're like, oh my god! You all missed it. My job is done. You missed it.
I can do the Black Butler like tagline in like under a second. Do you want to hear it? Really? Awesome. Okay.
Yeah, nice try.
Well, after all, I'm simply one hell of a butler. People are gonna make me guess. I love you all.
Evil Mania hands out there.
I know.
From now on, when I am on a panel with Tatum or Patrick or Chuck or Leah, I am bringing earplugs. Because all I hear, okay, as soon as I hear Black Butler, I just prepare myself. Okay. It's true. He's one hell of a butler. Let's see. Okay. I'll do Kyoko from Madoka Magica. Simple. I'll just put her dumb rookie ass out of commission. Permanently. I'm off a clumped.
Do you want to pick now?
Oh, yeah. Okay, there's a waving hand. Yeah, you. Yes, you.
All right, I have a
fast
ball. What is your opinion on
Yowie Fangirls? Fangirls? Yowie Fangirls?
She's
awesome. Go for it. Awesome, man! I don't know.
I mean... I'm not gonna lie. Yowie made me feel really enfranchised when I was young. It's important. Oh, you're like, oh, shut up. Yowie fangirls, though. I'm still trying to figure out. I mean, God love you. I love you. I really do. But I'm like, don't you feel left out? Don't you feel left out? That would tick me off. I don't understand that, but I don't care. It's awesome. I love that you support it because I sure as hell do.
You must say that for the
Yeah. Patrick, what do you think of
that? You see, you got the uke and the semi. And one's on the cover all smiling, the other one's behind him all like. I love this thing. The only thing that mystifies me was trying to figure out why everyone's like, no, Germany secretly loves Italy. I'm like, how much hate does he have to exude for him? Before you guys are going to think that like he walks off camera and he's like, actually, I love him so much.
Yes! Oh. Yes, he does. You just don't know it yet.
I mean, I hope that day arrives, because I'll be like, they were right. They were right all along. As of right now, I just figure he wants to, like, put him through a meat grinder.
Oh, no, Jeremy, why are you making a sausage?
And I can be like, yours are first.
You are henceforth banned from speaking and confined to each other.
Those are my thoughts on the Yowie.
I am a Yowie fangirl.
As he eats yogurt.
That's hot. That's hot.
Look at me while you do that. That's right.
Here's
my hotel room key.
I love it.
What? Great.
Lila, what?
Yowie!
He's over there on the phone looking up Yowie. What the hell is Yowie? I love it. What? Oh my god!
Have any of you been to a panel with Scott McNeil? Ever? Do you know who Scott McNeil is?
Yes.
Okay. He has the perfect answer to that. That's why they call it Yowie! You get it?
What does that mean? Who's got a question? Gentleman in the blue shirt, I see there.
Is it unusual for a voice actress to do multiple voice acting jobs at the same time? So like Black Butler and France on the same day? And do you mix up the lines as well?
That's really funny. Can I start?
Yes,
I have
yes,
an answer
please.
To that specific
please.
Thing because I was doing France. Excuse me. We were working on Black Butler season 2 and whichever later season of Italia at the same time, and it was one of those, and there was several other things, but two shows where I'm doing an accent, which is not common for us in anime because we usually just go with normal sort of neutral accents most of the time. But so I'm like, you know, I'd be 4, 5, 6, sometimes 8 hours in the booth. Doing voices like, you know, things like speaking like this as Sebastian for however long, and then you're expected to go and do France, or perform France. Which now just sounds like something I've had France performed on. And I lost the French accent. I've been doing this like role for 2 years or something, and I couldn't get into the accent. I was like, okay, so let's do this. And why is it coming out like this? This makes no sense. This is just not a French accent. And like Scott Sager, the director, was like, the hell is wrong with you? We only have an hour. Find the voice. And I'm like, aha! So I'm freaking out, and there just happened to be a blue Snuggie on the ground that I think Leah left there, right?
It was
the
Snuggie.
It was just there, and I don't know why, because I wasn't cold. I just saw the blue Snuggie, and I'm like, Scott, I'm going to put this on. I'm getting kind of a Frosty the Snowman Magic Hat vibe from this. So I put on this ridiculous Snuggie, which is blue and looks absurd. No one looks good in a Snuggie. No one looks good in a Snuggie. It's the most ridiculous. Look, it's a blanket with sleeves. I put this thing on, and of course I'm in this booth with like the glass wall so Sager and the engineer can see everything I'm doing, and I look ridiculous, and something about just looking ridiculous brought the accent out like that. Oh, silly days! I just have to put something ridiculous and blue on. And after that, and it was funny because like the first thing we did after that was France was like wearing something that looks like a dress, and he's like, "Look, it's me!" And I'm like, "Look at the miss cup." Scott is in tears, and I'm like, "I am going to do it every time I come and do that called France." And he made me wear it every time after that. So he stayed in there for years, or for months and months and months, and I wore it every time I played France. So that is how I cope with having to do that. I just need to study. I mean, it helped. Actually, it was during that same time, the same situation, because I was doing Italia, like, 6 hours, 8 hours, because when I go down there, I do, like, long days, because I gotta get home, doing Germany performing Germany.
We got spooking
and it's over. So voicing Germany all day and then doing Black Butler as Agni. And then having to go back for another hour after that to finish up Germany. I'm like, wait, where's your accent? It's sort of the epitome of first world actor problems. Oh no, I've got so much work on this day that I have to remember which accent to use. Privation. But thankfully, I mean, when we go in, whether it's that situation or if it's been a while since we've worked on that show, you can always just have them play a reference. They've got a reference, especially with the accent stuff, to make sure that you're consistent. Because maybe it's been a couple months. So they'll be like, hey, do you want a ref? And I'm like, yes, please, play the ref for me. I'll always take a reference file because I am wrong. You know what I mean? When I was actually like, oh, I remember. I'm like, no, I'm full of shh. So play me the ref. But yeah, no, it does happen. And it's weird when it does. It's like,
Not exactly on the same day, but there will be a day where I have a session, and then the next day I'll have a completely different project. And like Patrick, I always listen to the reference. Always. Because that's a big help. Very big help. Because otherwise I'll forget who I'm doing. or who I'm performing as. You know, a reference is such a big help. Such a big help. Chuck.
Yeah, references are good. That's how you remember the voice, because they record it and they can play it back and you can hear it. And it sounds like you, because it was you back then. And now you imitate the voice and it sounds like you.
It's like time travel.
It's still you.
Thank you very much.
I actually had a day like that recently. It was awful. I went in and recorded three girls, and it was like the entire spectrum of my vocal range. Sorry. I mean, it was so high altitude. Woo! Okay. So it was like the soft, breathy girl, the obnoxious girl, and then like the really high pitched, crazy elfin girl, and then at the very end of the day, I recorded a guy. And I'm usually very comfortable recording boy voices. I have no problem doing it, but for some reason, every single line, Colleen was just like, okay, you sound like a girl. You sound like a girl. Stop. And we had to record it. It was a beating, because I just could not get out of female voice.
Pick someone. The hair with the highlighter colored hair. Yes.
Have any of us considered cosplay?
Chuck's like, you.
Yeah, I've done it. I came as Dr. Stein one time. Which is cool because he's got a screw through his head. They didn't really put it through my head, it was fake.
Liar!
Life is a lie.
I want to start cosplaying as like not my characters. I want to like come as like Doctor Who. Or
Please do.
Oh my God. King.
No. I'll make a costume for you.
Oh my.
Who else? Cosplaying, anyone?
I would want to cosplay as Daenerys from Game of Thrones.
Yeah!
Is she naked?
No, she's not.
She got the dragons, is she naked?
She's naked. At the end.
So not like Baby Dragon today.
Not Baby Dragon. No.
What the hell is going on?
That's what I think every time you guys start talking. What the hell's going on?
I cosplayed as Okabe at the premiere of Steins Gate because I had.
But that's a very easy cosplay. It's like a lab coat and some jeans and a Dr. Pepper. All of like two of those things I have on me all the time. Anyway, it's not like I'm cosplaying. I might did something really elaborate. I would probably.
I can't pull off many of the characters I've played because they look nothing like me. I could probably pull off Scar. I would go as a Scar.
We're going Game of Thrones, man. I totally want to go as Khal Drogo.
I'm going to go as Khal Drogo because I have a huge crush on Khal Drogo.
I have a huge crush on Khal Drogo.
Yes.
That's the only reason why I saw the new Conan movie. Don't judge.
I'm pretty bad.
Don't judge. Well, as one of my characters, I would cosplay as Lychee.
Oh,
Lychee Fayling from Blaze Blue.
Go on.
Well, because I have similar glasses that she has. Like, I put my hair up in a
similar
bun. Yes, Patrick, I'm
this
going
back. This is about
backwards.
The glasses.
Nobody knows what you're talking about. Her nickname is the Booby Lady. So,
Booby Lady.
Booby Lady. Booby. Elementary, dear Watson. Has anybody seen the trailer for that new show, Elementary?
Yes.
I actually think it looks good.
Yeah.
Okay, Patrick, okay.
I'm a hater. If I ever did cosplay, no one would know. Because the internet is a cruel place. And that's all I need. Yeah, you would never know. I'd be out and about, walking among you. Maybe dressed as a banana.
You rock, banana.
You got a certain appeal.
Patrick, that was brilliant.
I could be a Joe Nana. But
don't speak, don't.
Leah?
Leah?
Did you cosplay or something?
I have never done that.
Well, we've never done that.
Would you?
Just that one time in college.
Would you?
Is there any character you would consider playing? Because you're
a
normal.
Babbit, you know. You know, Blair would be fun, I think.
Well, yeah.
We could be a banana tree.
We should all go as pieces of fruit.
Jelly, we'll be like a fruit of the loom man.
I'm
I want to be the grapes.
I like grapes.
Chuck, grapes, like.
It's your turn.
Chuck, you want to pick a question?
I'll pick a question.
I like grapes.
Right here.
Do you think you guys make a positive influence in people's lives and doing the work you've been doing?
I actually do have an answer for that. Somebody, for the life of me, I don't remember what project it was, what video game or what anime it was, but I was at an autograph signing, and a girl came up to me and she said, you know, I've been having a really crappy time in my life recently, and I just watched, I think it was Madoka, I'm not sure. That would make her feel really good about it.
Did she make a contract?
No, but she came up, and I wish I could remember what project it was, but she came up to me and she said, you know, that show was just really special to me, and it really just really helped me on those bad days, and so thank you very much for being a part of that. Thank you for doing that. And I was like, I didn't do nothing. I didn't do nothing, but thank you. It was really special to hear somebody say that. So the fact that I could help somebody feel better just through that performance or just through that show, I don't, you know, we were just talking about how sometimes there are shows that we watch to, you know, for comfort, and that's just very special to me that somebody said that.
Yeah, it's kind of weird, and the fact is, you just never know how what you've done, how it's going to affect somebody, like that you may never meet in person, you know, or something like that. And I've had several experiences where people come up to you and they say, you know, I was having, you know, like a really tough time in high school, being bullied a lot or something, but like one of the characters you played kind of became my imaginary friend, and they like kind of imagine them pep-talking me through it. And I mean, that's a very sweet thing, and that's awesome. And I'm like, I feel the same way. I'm like, I didn't mean to do that, but I'm glad that it helped. It's hard to own it because, you know, it's not like we had that in mind, but I mean, it's really delightful to hear that because, again, you just, I mean, that's really, I mean, I say this all the time, but I love what I do. I love voice acting. I love making silly voices and being in a padded room.
Tell them about the job, though, not about...
Yeah. And I love my job. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. I really, really enjoy it. You know, it's crazy fun working with friends all day and getting to be creative. And then, but really the best part about it is getting to come to conventions and hang with people like you, because I'm a total fanboy. Like, I grew up on this stuff, and I didn't get to go to cons because there was nothing near me. So it's really cool to just kind of be here, and I feel weird about being up here. Like, I should be down there going, Patrick Lang's talking about
It's so weird. It's so but I mean, it's great. I mean, it's wonderful when you have a positive, you know, influence on somebody. And sometimes
better than negative.
Yes, far better than negative. It's like
I haven't had anyone tell me the show I was in destroyed their life yet. Right. Like, when you voice so and so, it really put me on a dark path.
Yeah, because sometimes.
I mean, I have those days when I'm like, you know, I love my job. I wouldn't want to do anything else. I'm very lucky to have it. But sometimes you look and you're like, how am I helping the world by yelling like a ninja demon? So sometimes I'm like, I feel like I should be doing something more helpful. But then you get those occasions when someone's like, hey, that really, that character you voiced, that show you were in really helped. And even if it's just a matter of right place, right time, and whoever it would have been, you know, I don't take, like you said, you can't own it, you can't like take credit for it. It's just you happen to resonate with that person in that moment when they were going through a tough time. It makes you feel like, oh, okay, it's this isn't all just entertainment and sort of self pleasing. You know what I mean? Because it is such a fun job. At times, you feel like, should I be out there? Like, you know, I could be working in a soup kitchen 40 hours a week, but I'm not. And does that make me a bad person? You know what I mean? I mean, not to that extreme, but I do have those moments where I'm like, I got
should
mine.
Be saving starving children. Or
yeah, yeah.
Little does he know, most of the animes he's in do get fed to starving children.
So technically, he is
saving.
Your kid was fine.
I'm having the weirdest humor ever. I think that you guys make my life better. I think that, you know, as much as we've been able to do doing this, having you know, fans and people support your work is really, you know, it's helpful. I think it's a symbiotic relationship. We help each other, and mostly it's the anime, it's the stories. But I always tell my wife Kirsten when I get home, the anime fans are some of the best people in the world. Mm-hmm. Just really good people, good-hearted people. It makes our job fun.
You're ready to go.
I know. I'm ready to go. She has to answer the question first. I always feel like, I don't know, I'm always surprised when people do say that they are touched by something that I've done, because like they said, I don't know, I don't feel like it's making a difference, but I did have somebody write me a letter and say that they really related to Nautica. And they were happy that I played her and that they watch it when they feel sad and it helped them connect with certain friends. And I don't know, it was a long letter and it was a long time ago, but I just remember reading it going, oh wow, that's cool. It matters. Awesome. So, but it's a surprising thing.
I'm picturing people eating anime still.
It's a tender moment, Patrick.
Like a mortar and a pestle, they're making like DVD meal.
DVD flour.
Yeah. Yes. It's all glittery. Tastes like probably toxic.
Leah, I think it's your turn to pick somebody.
Pick someone, Leah.
Pick someone, Leah. Your turn. Pick away.
Oh. You have Starbucks. So.
She's like, give me that.
But if your life was a movie, what would the tagline be, the genre, and the title?
Oh, jeez.
Oh. Think about that.
That's a hard one. Too early today. Oh, man.
So what? The tagline?
Tagline, genre, and title.
Tagline, genre, and
title. Or one of them.
Mine would be, the Clementines are going to get you. Genre would be action, and the title would be Water Bottle of Death.
Duck Hunter Water Bottle, $5.
Eber! Banana's like, rejected! I think mine would be called Out of Sights, because that's my last name. And it would be like a screwball musical, like, caper heist film.
I want to make that! I want to see that movie!
I don't know what the tagline would be, but I'd be like, can I do the trailer for it? Because it's my life, and I've got a low voice. Like, that would only be fair. You know what? You guys keep going. I'm going to think of the tagline.
Okay.
You should
do the whole trailer. I want to hear the trailer video.
I don't have a tagline for mine, but the title would be Lenda Before Taima. In elementary school, my history teacher used to call me that. He used to call, my last name is Lenda, so he'd say, Lenda Before Taima. What's up? So that would be the title.
You beat him to death, didn't you?
With my Powerpuff Girls watch, yes, I did. I guess they're coming out with a new season, by the way, Powerpuff Girls. Either way.
More watches.
And the genre, documentary.
Like March of the Penguins documentary?
Exactly.
Every year, Lauren trips through the snow.
By Samuel Jackson. Yes. Oh. And I don't have a tagline because I'm not that creative right now, at least. Tato.
Oh God, I don't know. I you know what? Okay, I just off the cuff. I think mine would be like a Marx Brothers style, like ridiculous, like off the wall comedy. It would be called Banana Stickers.
See, we love
and
bananas.
The tagline would be the J stands for Jesus Christ.
Ooh, my tagline, it also, I guess, there'd be some, like, stoner comedy elements, because I need them for the tagline. I thought it would be like, this Christmas, it's not only the scores that are high, because there'd be, like, a pinball machine that they're trying to steal.
Pinball machine.
Yes!
Can I be in your room? Sure.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yay! That's how Hollywood works.
If only.
How's your turn?
Oh, it's my turn. Okay. You with the cat ears have been jumping up and yes, you.
Yeah.
You've been jumping at poor thing. You've been like, oh, you've been so disappointed.
She wants to get the laser pointer.
I have a question for J. Michael.
Oh, come on! It's the J. Michael.
She hates me so much.
I love him dearly. He
knows. Actually, pretty much have a question and a request, if I may. Mm-mm. The request would be, would you please sign my Triple X Holic book? And my question is, if Domaki, Kiyoya, and Sebastian were locked in the same room, what do you think would happen?
Just for that, I'm not signing your book. I can't sign it here because I've got an autograph signing session. They want to keep us nice and regimented, and I don't want like to start a feeding frenzy or you to get like attacked and stuff. So come to my autograph signing session. I have one today and I have one tomorrow. Well, there's one today. There's one today.
Like 2 hours from now.
No, it's like at 4. So come to that at 4. Come to that at 4. Hang on, I'm checking.
And he's stalling, so he doesn't have to tell you what would happen.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Yeah, it's, the autograph time is 4.
Okay.
Today, so come at 4.
For Tatum, autograph signing, 4 o'clock.
Yes.
Be there or be square. And for mine, it's at 2.
What would happen in that room?
So it's Kyoya, Domaki, and who else?
Sebastian.
Oh, Sebastian? Oh, God. I think Sebastian and Kyoya would like form an alliance because Sebastian would be like, you should totally be a demon. Why are we fighting? You know, sort of thing. Kyoya being Kyoya would be like, all right, I'm on board for this. And Domaki would just stand there and be going, what the hell is going on? Who are you people? What is, I'm just going to go leave and eat some sushi. I don't know. I can't even conceive of why they'd be in a room together.
That wasn't a sex because I was thinking the answer was going to be. I didn't think it was going to be like Survivor in a room.
They're in a room together. And you got Yuke and you got Jimmy.
I could be wrong, but I think we're out of time.
Are we out of time?
But thank you guys for coming to
this panel. Yes, you guys rock. Thank you so much.